Okay, so today we're going to talk about tips and tricks for deep margin elevation. The first thing that I want to share with everybody here is please don't forget to follow us at Romero Dental Seminars in Instagram and on Facebook. I also want to thank our sponsors. Thanks to them, we are able to offer a 1CE credit for this webinar today. These companies are Colteane, Oral Arts Dental Laboratories, and Garrison Dental Solutions. Thank you to them for their continued support. Don't forget to visit our webpage, romerodentalseminars.com. In this webpage, you will find under the webinars link, you will find three more links. The first link is the live webinars link, and that is the link that you can use to sign up for future webinars. This is our second webinar of the year. We will have 9 more coming up all the way down to December of 2021. The second link is our on-demand link, and the on-demand link is the one that you can use to go. You click there and you will go automatically to our YouTube channel within our webpage, or you can visit our YouTube channel at Romero Dental Seminars. In our YouTube channel, you will find all our on-demand webinars. The 2021 webinars, you will be able to to do your quizzes on demand, and you can send those quizzes in for us to grant you the 1CE credit. For the webinars that were completed in 2021, there are no more CE quizzes for those, so you will not be able to obtain CE credits on the previous webinars. But starting with the webinars on 2021, which is our endocrown webinar that is already on demand in our YouTube channel. And finally, you have our third link, which is the CE quizzes link. And that is the link that you're going to go visit right after we're done with today's webinar. I would say 10 to 15 minutes after we're done, so that you can go ahead and download the quiz that we have ready for you and complete the quiz. Once you complete the quiz, please do not forget to include your information on the bottom of the form and to sign that form electronically and then email it to us. You can also email a photo if you would like to print the form and complete it by hand. Once you do that, you want to email all the quizzes to romerodentalseminars@gmail.com. That is the email that we use to receive these quizzes. And then after that, we will go ahead and grant you the 1CE credit. Please, once you submit the quiz, it does take us approximately 3 to 4 weeks to generate all the CE credits and to submit them directly to the Academy of General Dentistry. If you are not a member of the Academy of General Dentistry, we will send you a verification form directly to your email address so that you can go ahead and submit it yourself to any other institution that will grant you credits for this webinar. Oops, give me just a second. I'm sorry, but something happened here. Okay. All right, I'm sorry for that. Okay, so what are our objectives for today in the morning? Well, our first objective is to understand when margin elevation is needed. Our second objective, how to effectively choose the biomaterial to elevate the margin. Third objective is going to be understand how and why to modify a Toffler-Meyer band. And finally, our fourth objective is going to be understand how to apply these concepts to restore severely broken down teeth. So let's go into our first tip and trick of the morning. And the question is, when? When do we elevate a margin? So let me share with you, and again, all my presentations are very clinical. My objective is always to share with you information that you can go ahead and apply tomorrow in your clinical practice. And let's first look at this particular case. This patient came in with some hypersensitivity on this premolar right here. This is tooth number 29, and you can see that large amalgam open margin on the buccal aspect, fractured amalgam right at the marginal ridge. So, it's kind of obvious why the patient was having some type of sensitivity or just symptoms on this tooth. Upon removal of the rubber, upon removal of the amalgam, the first thing that I want to share with you, and again, this is just the way that I practice dentistry. This is the way that I perform treatment. I'm an advocate of rubber dam isolation. I really enjoy performing rubber dam isolation on my patients, and I truly believe in the benefits of doing so from the get-go. So this particular patient, I isolated the tooth, and under rubber dam isolation, I removed the amalgam. And there's one reason why I do that. Initially, when I was removing the amalgam, when I saw this patient, I did not know I knew that the distal margin was deep. I just did not know how deep it was. So when these margins are below the gingival margin and they don't have any more enamel left, that is the ideal situation where you have to elevate the margin, or where it's one of the criteria for margin elevation. In this particular case, and this is the differentiating factor, in this particular case, after rubber dam isolation and after removal of the amalgam, we can all appreciate the amount of enamel that I still have surrounding this preparation. So if you think about that, you know, I do have very little tooth structure, solid, healthy tooth structure left. I have these very fine or thin buccal and lingual cusp. But again, I want you to look at the peripheral enamel coming from the lingual cusp all the way down to the mesial box, all the way up to the buccal cusp, and again, all the way down to the buccal distal box. So you can see that ring of enamel all around that preparation. And that is the substrate that I would like to use for this buildup. This particular tooth, I am going to complete an indirect restoration. I am going to complete an onlay restoration. And I'll talk a little bit about that in another webinar. But the reason why I chose that specific type of preparation and restoration is because of the availability of enamel and the preservation of this beautiful tissue on our tooth in order for me to achieve ideal bonding to that substrate. So the most important thing here is that because I have that ring of enamel, I am able to isolate. I am able to place a band around it. I know I can build up a core, and out of that core, I can then prep my tooth for an indirect restoration. So this is crucial when you're thinking about elevating the margin. I am sharing with you here this particular case where even though the amalgam was a large amalgam, the remaining tooth structure was, you know, it wasn't, there really was little tooth structure left. We still have that valuable enamel around the peripheral of this tooth that allows us to complete a really good bonding procedure. And when you look at this tooth after preparation, so all the procedures done under rubber dam isolation, if you think about it, I build up my core, I acid etch, I prime and bond, I build up my core, and then I went ahead and reprepped the tooth. And you can see that not only that I was able to prep the tooth and keep enamel surrounding this preparation, but at the same time, I was able to keep the entire surface of the tooth nice and clean. And now I know as well that at the day of delivery of the indirect restoration, I am going to be able to isolate and have full control of the operative field in order for me to deliver this indirect restoration. So having this ring of enamel is really the determinant on when I do and I don't do deep margin elevation. In this particular case, even though I have a deep margin on the distal, the margin is not deep enough where there is no enamel for me to bond to. I still have enamel here, and I'm going to take advantage of that enamel in order for me to bond either a direct, in this particular case, an indirect restoration. But the same situation will happen if you have a tooth that you are planning to do a direct restoration. If you have enamel, peripheral enamel and circumferential enamel around your preparation, you want to try to restore directly onto that enamel. That is the ideal clinical situation. And again, you can see here now, this is immediately after tooth preparation and removal of the rubber dam. And I want you to look at all the images. You can see the buccal image or the facial image. You can see my enamel and the way that the enamel just, you know, follows the actual lesion that was present on this tooth. Nice and round line angles, but look at the healthy enamel that I have all around. So we can all appreciate that in this tooth, even though my distal margin is deep, it is not below. I was able to preserve the margin to be above the gingival margin. So it's a deep margin, but it's a reachable margin. I could reach those areas. I can restore those areas. I can displace this tissue if needed with a cord. I can add a rubber dam isolation. I have access with my phosphoric acid to that enamel, and that is the best thing that you can do whenever possible. So this is the distinct factor between elevating the margin and non-margin elevation. Now I'm going to take you, you can see here the peripheral enamel, 360 degrees around my preparation. Now I'm going to take you to this other clinical situation because I want, again, my goal right now with this tip is to help you differentiate when are you going to elevate the margin, when you do not need to do margin elevation. Now look at this case. This is a different clinical case, different patient, and you can see that this patient had a fading root canal. If I'm not mistaken, this is tooth number 19, and you can see that she had a fading root canal here. But one of the most important things that I want you to see when I took this x-ray to verify, you know, the fading root canal, I want you to look at this margin on the distal of this tooth. And you can see how open that margin is. This patient presented with a very large direct restoration, and you can see with two fiber posts within the restoration to keep the restoration in place. But regardless of the post, and regardless of this post helping maintain this restoration in place, I want you to look at the cervical margin. I mean, if you look at how open that margin is, you understand why deep margin elevation is a must in a case like this. Now, do you have other options? Is there anything else that you can do besides margin elevation? And yes, the answer to that question is yes. You can do clinical crown lengthening. You can do ortho extrusion. There's multiple clinical options to help you, you know, bring that margin more coronal or supragingival. But you really have to choose which one is best for every specific case, because not every case can be handled or solved in the same way. So I want you to look at this, because if you look at throughout the procedure, this is before the root canal. This is immediately after the new root canal was performed. And now this is what I have right after the endodontist sends this case back to me. And again, you can see that the margin is still defective on that distal portion. So I have to do something about it. And my option here is going to be deep margin elevation. But I want you to look at something here. You see, in this preparation, this is totally different as the first case that I shared with you initially. There is no enamel on this distal margin. You can actually see how wrinkled my rubber dam is because of the depth of this margin. This margin is way below the gingival margin. So it's maybe half of a millimeter to a millimeter below the gingival margin. So that's why you see my rubber dam being wrinkled there, because that's the tissue is right above that gingival margin. And I have to make sure that I am able to invert the rubber dam. This is very, very important for you to understand. If you have a deep margin, and this deep margin requires deep margin elevation because that's the best option you chose for this patient, the number one rule for this to be successful is ideal rubber dam isolation. Without ideal rubber dam isolation, you will not be able to perform a margin elevation in this area that can be predictable. Regardless of the time of how long it's going to be predictable, you need to have good isolation in order for this to be predictable. Now, as you all know, and if you don't know, I'm going to give you this information now. If you visit our YouTube channel, we have two more than 1 hour length webinars directly related to rubber dam isolation. We have our basic rubber dam isolation webinar, and we have our advanced rubber dam isolation webinar that I would highly encourage you to watch if you don't use a rubber dam on a daily basis in your practice, just to help you solve the more complex situations like the one that you're seeing here in relationship to rubber dam isolation. So again, you need to make sure that you have good isolation, ideal in absolute isolation in this particular case, because if I don't have good isolation, just when I'm placing my Toffelmeyer band, I will be able to create some bleeding in that area that will affect for sure the bonding properties of any material that you will choose to use in that deep margin where there is no enamel and there is only dentin left in that area. So keep that in mind. This is the basic difference between having to elevate a margin when you don't have enamel, when you have deep dentin, and when you're subgingival, and not having to elevate the margin when you have enamel, when you are slightly supragingival, and you have really good control of the operative field. So what is my tip and trick number two? So my tip and trick number two now is, we now know when to do it. Now we have to know what can we use to make it work. What would be the ideal biomaterial? So, you know, as everybody knows, everybody that has been in our webinars, we try to stay away, from showing you evidence and from showing you studies as much as we can. This is really, these webinars are really meant to be clinical, to help you solve issues clinically. But there are some topics like this topic that we're talking about today that do require a little bit of literature, a little bit of extra information so that we understand where I want you to understand where I'm coming from. The most important thing that I want you to understand is that deep margin elevation or cervical margin relocation is actually the real or the first name that was ever given to this technique. The first time that this technique was ever published in the literature was in 1998 by DHT and Sprefico. Those were the two authors that came up with cervical margin relocation and with this technique. It is important for you to know as well that when they came up with this name and this technique, their number one choice as a biomaterial was resin composite. Is either a microhybrid or a combination of a flowable and a microhybrid composite. That was the specific material that they recommended for this technique. And there's a reason for that. The reason why they recommended these biomaterials for this specific technique is because they were doing indirect restorations for every tooth that they were doing cervical margin relocation. So think about that and keep that in mind, because that's going to become very important when I share with you another slide coming up very soon. It was Meunier and Sprefico in 2012 that renamed this technique and modified the name from cervical margin relocation to deep margin elevation. So in other words, cervical margin relocation and deep margin elevation are exactly the same thing, just two different names. They're both are recommending the use resin composite if you're going to use an indirect restoration. The beauty of the deep margin elevation is that it went beyond the indirect restoration. So when we're talking today about deep margin elevation, we're talking about direct and indirect restorative procedures. So keep those two names in mind. Now, just to share with you, this is a screenshot of a diagram that was specifically added to one of Dr. Dicci's manuscripts. And what I want to share with you here is just to give you an idea. All these restorations that you see here in light blue are all indirect restorations. And what I want to share with you here is that they are using, obviously, they're using a dental adhesive. They are using a resin-based composite as a lining or base material that you see here in yellow. But as you can see on this last photo, on photo number C, when they have a deep margin that is below the gingival margin and there is no enamel left, they are now elevating the margin. They're using that resin-based composite to bring that margin more coronal, to bring the margin more supragingival, to make it easy for them to not only obtain an impression or a scanning, but obviously to remove any excess cement at the day of delivery of the restoration. And this is why this technique is so valuable. Now, again, when you look at this diagram, now you will understand why rubber dam isolation is so critical. Because look at the area that you're working on. You're working on this area where you have crericular fluid and you're most likely going to have some gingival inflammation. If you are prepping a tooth that has a fracture restoration and has already had some plaque accumulation in that area. So you're always going to have this tissue that is going to be kind of puffy or red and it's going to be prone to bleeding. So that's why rubber dam isolation is so critical. And that is why I can tell you right now that rubber dam isolation would be that line from indication or contraindication, which means if you cannot isolate a tooth with rubber dam to do margin elevation, then this treatment option or modality is contraindicated for this patient. And that's very important that you understand. So I'm going to take you a little bit further back, because we know that around the 70s or mid 70s, this other technique, we had the revolution of the glass ionomers, and then closer to the 80s, the resin modified glass ionomers. And with all these materials, with these two materials, the glass ionomers and the resin modified glass ionomers, another technique came into operative dentistry, which is called the open sandwich technique. And there's really two techniques that are called sandwich techniques. There's the closed sandwich technique. And obviously the closed sandwich technique, meaning that you're going to you're going to close, you're going to cover that glass ionomer material with your resin composite, your direct restorative material. But then you have this open sandwich technique, which in essence is a margin elevation. The only difference is that when you're talking about open sandwich technique, you're specifically talking about using a glass ionomer in combination with a direct composite restoration, as seen on this diagram. You can see here the actual glass resin modified glass ionomer. The diagram has one mistake, and I'm going to share with you what that mistake is soon. But the actual benefit of this open sandwich technique is that you use a material that is less soluble in water, so it's affected less by any humidity or water present in the environment, and then more coronally, you bond a direct composite, which is more prone to failure in a wet or a moist environment. You relocate that margin in order for you to bond a resin composite on top of it. What is the mistake with this diagram that you're seeing here? The mistake is that when you do open sandwich technique, your resin modified glass ionomer should not be in contact with the adjacent tooth. Your contact should be reestablished 100% with composite resin, not with a resin modified glass ionomer. So please keep that in mind, because this is one of the failures of this diagram that was, you know, created and that was published in one of the articles. So you want to make sure that your contact is always restored back with direct composite. So what is the difference between open sandwich technique and cervical margin relocation? Well, basically the restorative material that you will be using for your final restoration. If you're talking about open sandwich technique, I know that you're talking about using a direct composite restoration on top of that resin modified glass ionomer. If you're talking about cervical margin relocation, I know that you are choosing an indirect ceramic restoration in order for you to restore that tooth. And at the same time that you are going to choose a biomaterial, a resin composite as a biomaterial for your margin elevation. So this is why today we have this new concept called deep margin elevation. And deep margin elevation is one term that can combine open sandwich technique and cervical margin relocation, meaning that you can choose with just one name, deep margin elevation. Okay, what material am I going to use? Am I going to use a composite at the end? I can go ahead and use a resin modified glass ionomer for that deep margin elevation. Or am I going to use an indirect restoration, and then I will have to choose a resin composite as my as the material of choice for that deep margin elevation? So really, this is what it comes down to. I have just shared with you a little bit of the history behind all this. But today, the term that we are using clinically is deep margin elevation, because it's one term that encompasses all these techniques, all these different techniques that came out throughout the years in order for us to be able to restore more complex class two preparations. So again, just with a clinical example, I think that it will be easier for me to just, you know, give you a sense of what we just, a summary of what we just, the information that we just shared with you. So you can see here this second bicuspid, the second premolar, and you can see how deep the proximal boxes are. On the right-hand side, you can see how deep the distal box is. And not only that the box is very deep, but the box wraps around to the lingual, so the affected dentin went all around towards the lingual. The infected dentin went all around to and cementum went all around to the lingual aspect of the root surface there, because the patient had some recession. And you can see here I have placed my band, and we will talk about band modification soon, but I have placed my modified band. And this modified band, there's a reason why you want to modify that band. And again, I'll share with you that in a couple of slides. But you can see now that I have filled, and for this particular case, I'm going to do deep margin elevation, and I'm going to restore this tooth with the direct composite restoration. So what am I going to use for my deep margin elevation? I'm going to use a resin modified glass ionomer. So you can see here, I have elevated first the distal margin, and I showed you how it wrapped around towards the lingual. Then I went and I elevated the mesial margin, both of these margins, and I normally, you know, just add the resin modified glass ionomer to stay a little bit shy of the band. So if my band has 2 millimeters in height, I'm going to stay maybe 1.8 millimeters I'm going to fill it up with a glass ionomer, and then you can always cut back. Keep in mind that your glass ionomer should not be in contact, should not be recreating the proximal contact. So if you add too much resin-modified glass ionomer and you do have and you do establish a contact, just use a burr and cut it back. Cut it back until you leave that openness so that you can place your second band, and then go ahead and use your resin composite as you are seeing here. I'm using now a new Toffelmeyer band, and you can go ahead and recreate your proximal contact areas by using this new band and pushing that tooth more distally with that large wedge that I am using as well to recreate a very nice and tight contact interproximally between these two premolars. So again, your resin modified glass ionomer just to elevate the margin, your resin composite to recreate the contact areas and to recreate obviously all the occlusal anatomy. So your functional areas are going to be within that composite resin. This is my completed restoration, and you can see it from the buccal. You can see it from the lingual. This is pre-op and this is immediately post-op. I want you to look at the photo because you can see the amount of bleeding that we had underneath the rubber dam and how well the rubber dam was able to keep that bleeding underneath the rubber dam so it would not affect at all my operative field. And this is crucial. You have to understand this is, again, what determines the usage of, or the indication or the contraindication of this technique. So, you know, we just have to improve and bring up our game when it comes to rubber dam isolation. And you can see here from the occlusal view and from the lingual view, a 12-month post-op, you can see the integrity, how the resin-modified glass ionomer has been able to be maintained well, and the junction between the resin composite and the resin-modified glass ionomer nice and smooth. So you always want to polish those areas, but you want to make sure that they're very nice and they have an intimate relationship so that there is no gap between one material and the other. You have to have a very smooth transition so that there is no plaque buildup in those areas. And that's very important. Now, that's case number one, where we were going to do a direct resin composite. Case number two, I'm going to do an indirect restoration. So immediately, when you're going to do deep margin elevation for indirect restoration, we know immediately that we have to think about a resin composite. And now, even though when the authors in 2012 came up with this, actually in 1998, when DHE came up with this cervical margin relocation concept, where he was already using resin to elevate his margin and to fabricate an indirect restoration, they were using a combination of flowable composite and with microhybrid composites. But today in the market, we have so much, there's a lot more newer composites that can be used for this technique. And I'm just going to mention some. You know, bulk fill, flowable bulk fills, medium viscosity bulk fill composites, like for instance, Philip from Colteen. That is a really good option because now you know that you have a material that has medium viscosity that you can inject within the cavity preparation and is going to have better wettability. So you don't need now to combine a resin, a flowable resin with a microhybrid with the newer materials that we have today in the market. So keep that in mind because that's what I'm using. I'm trying to use medium viscosity bulk fills in order for me to be able to create the ideal wettability of the area. And this is what you're seeing right here. So I place my band, and again, we'll talk about the way that we section the band, and you can see how I was able to fill that cavity using this medium viscosity bulk fill composite to fill everything up from that dentin all the way up to the occlusal surface to make sure that my restoration now has a new margin. That margin has been relocated supragingivally, and what that means is that I am able to access my margin in a better way with my scanner or with my impression materials. The other thing that I want you to understand is that these materials, these medium viscosity flow bulk fill composites, can be used as core builder materials. So I actually put them all around the tooth and just make sure that I get into any irregularities within the tooth so then I can just incorporate them into my buildup. And the other thing that I want you to know is that once I do this, I rarely make impression the same day. And there's a reason for that, because obviously I have a band, I have a rubber dam, I have a floss ligature. I have placed so many things subgingivally that the tissue is irritated. So what I normally do is I just put my temporary restoration on top of that elevated margin. I send the patient home and I wait a couple of weeks. This photo was taken 2 weeks after my margin elevation. And you can see now that I'm probing that area and there is no bleeding upon probing because the tissue is nice, firm, is healthy. The patient is being able to keep that new supragingival margin clean. I have a very nice and smooth transition between the two surface and my my medium viscosity bulk fill composite or Philip from Coltine. So I have, you know, I have created a better environment in that subgingival area where I'm able to, as you can see, probe and there is no bleeding upon probing. So I know that I'm ready to restore. And again, one more thing that I want to share with you is you, when you do these margin elevations, you want to make sure that you take an x-ray. And you can see here that transition between the tooth surface and my composite resin and how supragingival it is now. But the most important aspect is the anatomy of this emergence profile. Very nice and straight, the way it should be. And another thing that I want you to see is that we haven't recreated a contact. We have enough space here for our indirect restoration to recreate the contact area between this second molar once this is restored and this first molar here. And I'll show you that photo soon. So you can see here, we have scanned the area. We have created a model with the scanner, and then we go ahead and mill the restoration. We stain the restoration, and you go ahead and deliver that indirect restoration. I do want to mention that we don't do our restorations in-house. I send them out. I normally work with Oral Arts Dental Laboratories. They are the ones that delivered, that fabricated this restoration for me. I send them my, I email them my STL files. They're able to then download them in their lab in Alabama, you know, and then go from there. So I get this restoration back from them and I'm going to go ahead and, you know, deliver the rest, this rest, indirect restoration, again, following a good adhesive protocol. We're not talking about that today, but you have to follow a good adhesive protocol. You have to have good control of your operative field. You can see that we have a rubber dam isolation. Again, much easier to achieve rubber dam isolation today because now we have all our margins supragingival. We are able to reestablish interproximal contacts, adjust the occlusion, polish the restoration. And I want you to see, this is 12 months. This is 1 year post-op. And you can see, this is the area where our resin, where our medium viscosity bulk fill is working and behaving well. This is resin composite. And this right here is the interface between my ceramic restoration and the resin composite. So you can see how supragingival my margin is. An area where the patient can maintain that area clean. A patient, you know, can anybody, the dental hygienist has good access to clean and polish that area every 6 months when the patient comes for her hygiene checkup. So it's a, it's an area that is maintainable for the patient. So this is the lingual view. This is the buccal view. And we're ready for our tip and trick number three, which now comes down to the band, the Toffelmeyer band. And there's many ways that you can do this. I'm just going to share the way that I prefer doing it. I don't like buying, you know, special things for every single procedure that we perform in our clinic, because then we would never end up having all these toys in our practice that we, you know, rarely use. So I rather use things that I have in my office. And that's what I'm going to share with you today. Now, why do we modify a Toffelmeyer band in order for us to be able to make this band help us achieve what we want to achieve when we're talking about deep margin elevation? And the number one reason for that is this. This is a stock photo, and I am very clear there. This is not my photo, but the information on the photo I did add to. And what I want you to see is that when you're doing a regular class two and you're using a Toffelmeyer band, what the Toffelmeyer band does for you, the shape and the form of this band, is that when you have it in place, the band flares occlusally. And the reason why the band flares occlusally is for you to be able to reestablish that interproximal contact. So that is just the way that the band is designed, and it's a really good feature for this band when you're using it for regular class twos. But it's not a good feature when you're trying to elevate the margin, because your goal, again, when you're trying to elevate the margin, is only for you to achieve your emergence profile. And that emergence profile should be no more than 2 millimeters supragingival. So my idea and my goal, you can see here that if I section this band in half, I'm only going to get the straight aspect, the straight profiling aspect of the band in that margin, in that elevated margin. And that's what I'm looking for. I don't want to have to use a wedge. And I'm going to share with you at the end of the modification of the band why you do not want to use wedges for your margin elevation techniques. This is the number one reason why I like modifying the band in order for me to elevate the margin. And this is what we do. We cut the band, we cut the occlusal end of the band in half. So we section this portion using a scissor and we eliminate what you see here in blue that I have stained with a blue pen. This is the portion that I'm going to cut off the band. And this gingival half is the one that I am going to actually use clinically. And you will see how this happens. This is now the band. I have sectioned with my scissors this occlusal half of the band. I throw it away. And what I'm going to use is the gingival half. Now, I do not cut the band all the way to the ends of the band, because obviously if you do that, then you're going to have difficulty keeping that band attached to your tougher Meyer retainer. So that's why I always leave the tabs at the ends so that I can attach this band to a regular tougher Meyer retainer. But when you fold the band, you can see now, you can understand the straight emergence profile, the band, when you section the band, there is no flaring of the band anymore, or the flaring is minimal. But most importantly, this band right now is maybe 2 to 3 millimeters in height. So if you think about it, now you have something that can help you control the thickness of your biomaterial when you're elevating the margin, because all you need is 1 to 2 millimeters super gingival. So you can say, okay, I'm going to fill this gap. I'm going to fill this box halfway to the height of the band. And you know that you have 1.5 millimeters of the material. And as well, you know that you're not going to achieve any contact. So let me show you a clinical example. Now, this clinical example is a case that I did with one of the dental students at the Dental College of Georgia a couple of years ago. But what I want to share with you is that this band was not cut enough. You need to split the band more, because you can see here that the student, once they elevated the margin, and because we had enamel on that deep margin, guess what biomaterial we were going to use? We were going to use resin composite. So this is resin composite bonded just to elevate the margin. We cut back a little bit, because you can see that she was able to achieve a little bit of a contact here. So we have to remove that so that we can then place our second band, displace the neighboring tooth, separate these teeth orthodontically so that we can recreate a very nice tight contact between both of the teeth. So again, keep that in mind. This is the reason why you want to section the band. But this is the most important reason why you want to section a band, the one that I'm going to share with you right now. This case here was a case that I just shared with you previously. You remember the root canal treated tooth, and you can see the open margin. When you look at this x-ray in the middle, which is a straight-on x-ray that was taken by the endodontist while performing the root canal, I want you to look at this indentation that you can see on the restorative material that the previous dentist had placed to restore this large restoration. And when we look at that and you put a wedge in there and you look at the shape of this wall of the wedge and you look at the shape of the composite, you can see what's happening here. You see, if you do not elevate the margin, or when you're elevating a margin, you use a wedge, most likely your wedge is going to push that band within the preparation, because there is no tooth structure there to hold this wedge in place. There is no tooth structure there that you're going to be able to wedge against. So you're literally wedging against the actual metal band. And that is the number one reason why you want to section the band, and why you do not want to use wedges when you're elevating a margin. So you avoid pushing the metal band within the preparation and then ending up having this weird looking anatomy within that restoration. So that is the number one reason why I recommend sectioning the band in half and not using wedges when you're elevating the margin. And again, don't forget, the margin elevation should not reestablish a contact. So if you think about that, you do not need a wedge to separate any tooth. Once you've elevated the margin and you light cure that material that you've placed in your margin elevation, then you can now place a new band. Now you can wedge, because now you have something to wedge against. you have that polymerized either resin composite or resin modified glass ionomer that you can wedge against. And now you're able to reestablish that contact. So, you know, that's just a good reason and a good tip that I'm sharing with you so that you can use clinically. And my fourth and final tip for the day is the how to use these techniques for severely damaged teeth. And when I'm working on severely damaged, broken down teeth, and when you look at the case that I'm going to share with you today, you'll see what I'm referring to, severely broken down teeth. You have to most likely combine these concepts with other biomaterials. And one that I like using a lot when I'm working on severely broken down teeth, and I'm thinking about restoring these teeth with a direct restorative material. And again, the reason why I'm doing that is most likely because of financial reasons. My patients cannot afford an extraction and an implant at this time. My patients cannot afford a posing core and a crown and a clinical crown lengthening. So I have, you know, there's financial reasons that will push me to this type of option and at least prolong the lifespan of the tooth until we are ready to do more of a definitive type of restoration. But, you know, surprisingly, when I do these type of procedures, you know, they last a pretty good time in my patient's mouth, and they give us the time to plan accordingly so that we can go to a more definitive option. And this is the tooth that I'm going to restore here with you right now. This premolar here that had, you know, had a root canal for over 20 years. The root canal was in good conditions. There was no, you know, the root canal was not exposed. This tooth had fractured just recently. The root canal was not exposed to the oral environment. And there was no periapical lesion. It was a solid, nice root. This tooth needed to be extracted. An implant most likely needed to be placed. But again, financially, the patient right now had a couple of issues going on, you know, a lot of caries in different areas of the mouth. And we were going to focus on getting all the teeth that can be restored and saved. We wanted to save them. So we were going to put all our efforts into those teeth first, extract the teeth that were not restorable, like the second molar here that we were not planning to restore, not even in the near future, but try to save as much teeth as we can and try to, you know, restore these severely broken down teeth to a way that, okay, we're not going to put the patient right now in the expense of an extraction, an immediate implant, or a bone graft, because, you know, we don't know when she's really going to be or he is going to be really ready to go to the next step. So this is when all these concepts come into play. Again, the number one thing and the number one reason why I know that I can do this and I can benefit my patient by means of this restorative techniques is rubber dam isolation. If I am able to isolate, I am able to keep my margins clean, I am able to control my operative field, I am going to be able to restore this tooth. And that is what I'm looking for. So first and foremost, rubber dam isolation. Once I have rubber dam isolation, now I remove what the patient had to seal the previous restoration that was there sealing the endo access. I remove that, and you can see that now I am preparing 3 to 4 millimeters within the root canal. So I'm eliminating some of the gutta percha, 3 to 4 millimeters at the beginning of these canals. And what I'm going to do then is I'm going to elevate the margin. You see, I'm using resin composite. I elevated the margin circumferentially, and then I added fibers. I actually added the fibers first. I added both buccal and lingual fibers on the canals, and then I elevated my margin circumferentially. So now I am 1 millimeter above the gingival margin. I'm 1 millimeter above, you can see my rubber dam isolation. So now I know that I am my new margin is in an easier area for me to restore. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to build that tooth up, and you can see from the lingual view, you can see how much margin elevation I was able to achieve, mesial, distal, lingual, and buccal. And you can see these fibers, fibers sticking out through the center of the tooth. These fibers are the ones that I'm going to bond the whole tooth structure to keep this restoration in place. Before I did this, I had made an impression of the patient, and I had waxed a tooth up, and I created these matrices that would help me develop a buccal and a lingual wall. And that's what you're seeing here. I have now finished my buccal, my lingual wall. I have been able to place a band, wedge. And why am I able to wedge? I'm able to wedge because I elevated my margin. So my wedge is wedging against what? It's wedging against the neighboring teeth and is wedging against that margin that I elevated using resin composite. Now I'm going to be able to build my proximal walls and fill the gaps and complete that restoration. So this tooth right now is 100% composite combined with fibers, with resin fibers. And then I go to the next tooth. And again, no enamel here. I'm going to go ahead and elevate that margin. Elevate the margin, restore all the contours of that tooth. And then, you know, little by little, start working around her entire mouth and go and make sure that I restore. But I just want to share these two teeth. I did her entire mouth with resin composite. Then we started with some extractions and stuff like that. But this is a side view. This is probably, I would say, 5 days after the restoration was in place. Right now, this restoration has been in place for 8 months, close to 8 months. And again, we haven't made a, we're still working on other areas to improve other areas, but this restoration is there. The root is still there. So I'm able to maintain the bone. I'm able to maintain all that surrounding area, the tissue, everything I need in order for me to be able to take the next step when needed, when the patient is ready for me to do so. But I'm giving her a long-term temporary restoration that has been restored using many, many of these concepts, you know, in the best way possible. So, you know, with that, I'm open to any questions, and I'm going to go ahead and open now.